I was born in Vancouver, BC. I had seven other sisters and brothers. They were all born in Vancouver.
Well, I was born in Vancouver, British Columbia, 1925. And then my parents were born in Japan, in Fukuoka.
And my mother and father, they're from Hiroshima, Japan. They were born in Hiroshima.
I was born in Prince Rupert, British Columbia. My parents were born in Japan.
Well, my name is Setsu Oda. That was my maiden name. I come from Duncan, Vancouver Island.
I had one brother and four sisters. They're all born in BC.
I have two older sisters, an older brother and two younger brothers. And we were all born in BC. And my mother and father are from Japan.
A lot of things they taught me, things about Japan.
Tell us to read Japanese because we were going to the Japanese language school at that time. What I learned in Japan all the year, everything is given into our mind that we are the perfect country. When I was there, Japan was doing all the good things to the neighboring country. And when I came back to Vancouver and started reading some of the Japanese paper, I have not known anything. It was kind of discouraging, you know, that we were brainwashed over there. In a very short time, 5 years, I was there. You know, they'll brainwash you and brainwash the public.
Well, it was on a Sunday.
I myself, at 19 at the time, felt no discrimination.
Just surprised that Japan would attack Pearl Harbor, but to tell you the truth, we really didn't know where Pearl Harbor was.
Most of my friends were whites.
Soon after the war, they wanted to, as you know, evacuate all the Japanese from the coastline.
But as soon as the war started, and we gotta move out of BC, some of the friends, so-called friends, turned against us.
They didn't know where to put us. I think it's called the Pacific National Exhibition.
We were in Hastings Park for 3 months,
where there were a lot of big buildings that they could put us.
We couldn't have any cameras, and what we took was just our clothing.
They had to clear out the stalls for the animals for us.
We used to have bunk beds. My parents slept downstairs, and we slept on the top bunk. So we used to always wait for the Mounties to come around to check.
And there would be people outside looking at us and calling us Japs and things like that, but we tried to ignore that.
The Mounties were very nice about it, you know. Well, when we got first, we went to a place called Pop-Off, and we had to sleep in the tent for maybe 1 month before we got into Bayfront because the house wasn't ready. You have to have 7 people living in a house. And then we used to get water from, the truck used to come every so often and they bring us water. We did our own washing outside. My parents lived in Lemon Creek, that's 7 miles from Bay Farm. We kept our Japanese cultures right through. We were taught from our parents the cultures, so we kept it up.
We were in Hastings Park from April to September. These, the ghost towns, which were mining towns, and the old buildings were there. I guess little shacks there for us. They weren't insulated or anything. The houses in Lemon Creek, which is about 7 miles from Slocan City, and there were also other camps there, Pop-Off, Bay Farm, and then Lemon Creek was. And I think Lemon Creek was quite one of the bigger camps. Well, when I turned 16, I went to the RCMP office and had to get my registration card with thumbprints and identification if you had any occupation. So I guess we're kind of virtually prisoners right into the camp, but there were no guards or anything, you know, walking up and down. There wasn't any barbed wire or anything, but there were mountains and there was no place where you can escape. The Isseis, especially the first generation, didn't think that Japan would lose the war.
we were relocated to Scriber, forced relocation, of course, because of the war. It was April the 1st, 1942, that we reached Scriber. We were building the road from Scriber to Terrace Bay, the Trans-Canada Highway from Scriber to Terrace Bay. I was allocated the job of being the bull cook. End of May, we took a train, reached West Toronto, and we had to stop over there. A lot of people on at the station that was looking at us, they thought we were prisoners of war, but we were speaking English. They said, look, they can speak English. I would say 95% English and 5% Japanese to our parents.
In 1942, my brother and I were the only one that's living in Canada as far as the Oshimo family is concerned. We got the notice of taking a train to the road camp. There was a regulation. Nobody's supposed to be outside after dark. And he got caught walking home that night. So he was sent out to Petawawa in Ontario. I wasn't following the government's order to move out. That's when I met my brother at Angler. They moved out of Petawawa and I got into Angler the same day. Angler, internment camp, there's a lot of things, nice thing going on. You could learn kendo, judo, learn English or Japanese. But the thing I regretted was the time we had to bow toward the east. I guess everybody followed what the camp leader told us to do. Some group in that bunch that was brainwashing a lot of those second generation what to expect when the war ends.
Well, we left Lemon Creek in 1946. We arrived here in July.
It was a good feeling, just the same. I can't recall too much about that time.
I like Fort William anyways. I did like it.
We lived in the East End, and in the East End there were a lot of different ethnic people. There were Italians and Ukrainians, and they just took us as who we were and never... I don't think there was any objections about us moving in there. And there were quite a few Japanese families at first living in the East End. But as we got older and got married, we all came out. And as you can see, there is no one place that all Japanese are grouped together in Thunder Bay, or you won't even find that in any of the bigger cities, because that's the way, I think that's the way it started. They didn't like us being in one place, so now we are dispersed all over the place.
We're living in Fort William. We're at the bunkhouse and at the sawmill. A bunch of them came into town, and they were called Japs. And this one guy picked on the biggest guy in the group and threw him on the ground. You know, after that, he had no trouble. And that's the only incident I've heard of that anybody tried to discriminate or belittle the Japanese. I was extremely disappointed in the treatment the Canadian government gave us, because being born in Canada, if you're not a Canadian, who is?
As you know, evacuation means a lot of tough things ahead. We don't know what to expect, but it turned out quite well. Even during the war, we were treated quite well.
People still think that we're aliens because we look different. You know, enemy aliens, because we look different. And they compare us with the treatment that the Japanese government did with the prisoner of war in Hong Kong, and they were soldiers fighting against Japan. You know, they were really, like, the Canadian soldiers were fighting against Japan, so they really were prisoners of war. But we were Canadians, so you can't compare us the same way.
It was a good move for us coming here.
But when we came here, we didn't experience much of discrimination. I think this is one good thing we were experiencing at that time. You know, very, very quiet life.
I'm a Japanese. As far as I'm concerned, I'm Japanese. So I do things the way I was taught from my parents. And I try to teach my children a little bit of Japanese heritage, which a lot of them, they do enjoy it. I know my grandchildren, they love to know a lot about Japanese and this and that. So it depends on how you feel, I guess, more than anything else.
They're doing the right thing, being a Japanese. Yes, and this is why today I'd like to pass some of it to my sons, and my son will do the same for their.
I belong to the different clubs and organizations. And in fact, I was the president of the West Park Kiwanis Club, vice president of West Thunder Community Center. I was the executive of the YMCA. And I got along well with most of the Occidentals. They say, how do I feel because I'm Japanese? I say that I can't see myself. Just like you, you can talk to people, but you can't see yourself in, just like you're in a mirror. So I figure I'm just as good as the rest of you. Like I was just said, I was president of the West Park Kiwanis Club, and you get a guy, you got to stand up in front of people and talk and make speeches. Yet you're the president of the organization, and you're talking to 99% whites. You have a little, well, in English, means hold back, and you do hold back a certain amount.
I was young enough, too young, I guess, to feel bitter. I think all that bitterness comes out after when you grow up and then you feel, why did they do this to us? But I think, sure, we were, you know, we wondered why we were treated this. What we knew why is because we were Japanese, but we were Canadians also. I think people can't understand that we were born in Canada. You know, most of us, my mom, my dad were naturalized. And we regard this as our home. Sure, we look different, but you know.
1988, when the Prime Minister Brian Mulroney apologized to the Japanese Canadians and the Japanese for the treatment they gave us. At that time, the NAJC, National Association of Japanese Canadians, wanted the government to say that they will never have discrimination of that sort again, or have the War Measures Act. But it's happening right now for the Afghanistan people, who are just ordinary people living in Canada. People is discriminating against them.
Yes, as soon as we heard about that, I said to Paul, they're going to be treated just the way we are because they're visible minorities. You know. When it first happened, maybe it's kind of backed off a little bit now and trying to be more fair about these things because they remembered what they did to us. But it's hard being a visible minority. You think of yourself as Canadian, but even our friends think we came from Japan. And how many times have we told them we're born in Canada? Or they'll say, you speak good English for
him. I always say, as long as there is different colors, there's going to be discrimination.
As far as we're concerned, I have my three kids, three boys. They're all married now, and they're living in Toronto, one in Niagara Falls at the moment. But I hope that they will never, never, ever experience anything like we went through. The people all over the world, they're getting closer to be together and try to understand the human relation. It's a beautiful world, and we should be able to live in one like that. Yes. With the sister city being the Anaizu, you know, we more so try to keep out the culture in Japan. And the third generation here is doing a great job trying to keep keep the level as before.
Yeah, because the third generation, they like to keep up the culture too. They don't want to stop that. They want to keep up the culture as much as they can.
I'm proud to be a Japanese Canadian. No doubt about that.
Proud of my heritage.
Being a Japanese, I don't care what anybody says, I'm still a Japanese no matter what.
I don't feel ashamed to being Japanese.
You know, to be proud of who you are.